did get some feedback in the, interim from a couple of people to pick up some of the policies and do some of their homework, most notably Brendan and Robin. And in order to clarify some of the questions that people had, and so we can kind of get down to what it is that we can do, you know, to make the changes and to modify things and to make things better, I thought it would be better that I bring in a couple of guest speakers, if you will, just to clarify. Because as she found out with some of her questions, there are certain things within some of these policies that the Cohoes Police Department doesn't have any kind of purview over or any influence over. And one of them is a lot of the civil service related things. There is a Cohoes Civil Service Commission, and correct me if I'm mistaken, Carol or Mayor, that is appointed, the members of which are appointed by the mayor, correct?
Correct.
For this Cohoes Civil Service Commission. Mm-hmm. So any questions you would have about that would be one that would be better off addressed to him. And then when we get into the physical fitness aspect, Brenda, I know this was questions you had, maybe Ron, I think you collaborated on these,
yes.
Questions. Okay. So what you had and the things I wanted, first of all, this is Carol Radman, she's secretary.
Right, so I'm the secretary to the Civil Service Commission. And so the commission is made up of three members appointed by the mayor. The civil service commissioners then appoint a secretary to the commission that acts as a de facto personnel director, shall we say, in the realm of the civil service operation. So the secretary carries out all of the duties under civil service law on behalf of the three commissioners.
Now, are all three commissioners Cohoes residents?
They are. Yes, they are.
And Carol, you have how many years experience?
So I was the secretary to the commission from 2000 to 2013. When I resigned, I left. I'm now the director of human resources for Capital Region BOCES. I came back in September of 2019 as a favor to Mayor McKeeler to help to address some shortcomings in the office from previous leadership. And then I will be leaving at the end of December. We have a replacement coming on. Her name is Emily Schilfer. So she'll be assuming my role and responsibilities. But I will also be helping her as we go along and teaching her the aspects of the office. Just I won't be carrying out the day-to-day operations.
So my purpose, and I'll break down and meet with the individual groups like we talked about, but I think she can clear up a lot of things for all the members here, and that way we can move on and kind of get more into the real work that we can accomplish. So some of the questions that Brenda had and that Carol can clarify are questions pertaining particularly the way they're worded. I'll just read them word for word, Brenda, you're fine with that, right? Are people of color notified that they are still eligible to test on even after failing the fitness test? Now to clarify that, do you mean when they fail one aspect of it or the test in the whole?
So when they fail the one aspect of it.
Okay.
We saw, actually Robert put this time, but once they fail one, they already notified if they wanted to try again.
So,
okay.
Yeah.
I just want to clarify, you meant like if they fail one aspect, like the push-ups and sit or in general they fail, what happens in the next part of the process?
Well, technically if they fail one of the criteria, then they are disqualified.
And they are notified at that time, which was one of the questions she had. Immediately, they're notified that they did not pass the push-ups or sit-ups. Now she can speak on what happens next.
So the process is all candidates are sent a letter saying you're being called for an agility test. It's disclosed in the exam announcement. If you fail to show up when called upon, unless you get an alternate test date or you get make some kind of an arrangement with the civil service office for an alternate test opportunity because of certain criteria. If you don't show when you're called upon, you're automatically disqualified. That is disclosed in the exam announcement. It is further disclosed in the exam announcement that if you fail any portion of the agility test, you are disqualified from further consideration. Furthermore, there is no second time. That's one and done. Well, the policy here has been, it's a one-time test, the agility test, for the length of that list.
But that's not what it's reading
here.
Right, and the policy that I gave you is one of the ones that I explained before, and I have another person to speak on the accreditation aspect. these policies are being changed, modified, corrected, and that's one of the ones that is not finalized yet. So I can see where you read what you read in the selection process, but that is not a finished product policy. You need to make the correct changes and modifications to that one.
And it needs to reconcile. The policy needs to reconcile. With civil service. I'm going to take a look at that for Chief Walden and make those recommendations of where these things should be right sized to what the operation in the civil service law, the policy.
Right, for the policy.
Yep.
For the state.
Well, we're a local commission. So
you guys are doing, okay, so you supersede just for this area.
We have this.
Correct.
We have to go by that. This is New York State Civil Service Law, and it's a guide. It's what we have to do is set out in the law. The agility is also set out in the law. That's part of this binder as well. So
did they change that? Because civil service, a couple of our guys in the sheriff's office failed.
Yeah.
And then they were able to take it again.
Because they adopted a local policy that gave a second chance.
So it's a local.
We don't have that.
Okay. All right.
You can adopt that here.
Okay.
If that's something that you would want to have reconsidered, the commission would have to look at that.
Okay.
And it would have to make a determination whether or not that's in the best interest of the public.
The public?
Yes. You know, they look at it in the greater good, the best interest of everyone. Yep.
Well, since we're looking for change in our town, in our city,
mm-hmm.
I think that should be something that should be changed.
Okay.
The fact of the matter is the people who we want to hire are failing.
They're failing the agility test?
Yes.
Okay.
So, I don't know if when we get a person of color, when they come to you and say, can we prepare them for that?
So they get notified of the examination. They get the outline of what they will be tested on. There's three criteria, sit-ups, push-ups, and a run that they have to do. So they are notified, they're given 1 month's notice in advance to prepare for that. So, I mean, they are notified what they have to do.
The people who are failing is who we want. The people who are failing is what makes our city great. We want them because when we see them, it makes us look like a great city. So it's our job as a city to do something so that they can pass. I don't know what it is for us to do, but we're a team.
Well,
so as a team, shouldn't we find a solution?
Well, that's in our conversation when we had our meeting. That's the route. It has nothing to do with you.
Right. You want
to.
Right.
So basically, we want to be able to have.
That would be apart from civil service itself. That would be something that we could look at, you know, otherwise, but that would not be something that civil service would put into place.
Correct. I just wanted to make clear is they are given full, knowledge long in advance that you are going to have to take an agility test. And this is a criteria. It is announced on the exam announcement, and then again, it's reiterated in a letter calling them in for the agility test with at least 1 month's notice so that they have time to prepare. So, I think you're asking for something outside
right.
of that, and yes.
And that's something we can discuss, but I just wanted to make it clear what the part of the service plays, what is the part that we can do so that
for making concession of maybe a second opportunity.
Correct. That could be something that you would have to put forward,
correct.
Or the mayor would have to put forward,
okay.
The chief would put forward for consideration by the body of the Civil Service Commission,
correct.
to make that a change.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but if it's made a local law, then aren't you prevented from saying whether it's good or public or not, or would you rather us not make it a law and just put it forward to the commission?
when the policy is adopted, we have to publish the policy. When we announce the exam, it has to be published so that people understand the contract between us and the people that are signing up to take the civil service exams.
Okay, so first thing that you made the policy for you, you actually drafted it. It is then given to you, you guys would look at it, publish it.
I misunderstood your question. So, yes, you could bring forward your recommendation for consideration. They would have to look at it and decide, do we want to make this change to our current policy? They, the commissioners, would. It would be done at a meeting.
How often do changes come before the commission?
It depends.
We've done none this year, right?
What's that?
We've done none this year.
No, we haven't. There's been...
My worry is the rate of change that the commission is willing to accept.
Well, I think that people, they're very open-minded people. So, I mean, if it's something that is agreed upon out of the body of the year, that this is the direction you want to go, you have every right to bring it forward to the commission and ask for the consideration.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Right, just a follow-up question, because when you say that the people that are failing are the people we want to hire, I don't necessarily follow you there. I mean, who are the people that failed the fitness test? We had three people show up, and all three of them failed.
Right.
What is it about them that we want to hire?
Well, you know, sometimes, a lot of times, just because somebody failed a test doesn't mean they can't do the job.
Mm-hmm.
And in this town, in our city, we don't have a minority worker. Someone that looks like me, that's on the police force, all working in city hall. So, if someone comes in and they look like me, and they continue to fail the physical exam, then it's our job as the people of this city to find a way. That's all I'm saying. I mean, because like I said, somebody may not walk fast, but somebody can run faster than the person. You get what I'm saying? So we need to train these people. If we have to send them to a gym to use other
drugs. No, that's exactly what we're saying. Obviously, they're failing for whatever reason. They're never failing. So if we can meet them before that and say, listen, alright, you have a mile and a half. This is what we're gonna do. You have a month. You have push-up, you have a month, you have sit-ups. Because I know we sit here and say they should be able to, but you know something? Some of the people, some of the candidates of color really don't, they wanna be a part of this, but when they don't see people of their own color, they begin to get intimidated. They walk into a room already thinking they're going to fail.
Right, they think that's a recruiting, that's something that's mystifying the process.
Yeah.
I'm doing a lot of this work already in my full-time job because we're trying to diversify our workforce. So it's getting to those populations and demystifying the process. Letting them know what the process is. A lot of people don't understand the civil service process. Especially people, black and brown people. They're intimidated by the process. Can I take that test? Can I pass that test? There's barriers. The barriers to moving
Well, I just adopted the Cooper, right. What you guys use, so, I mean, that's, you know, I look through and...
I think we could do an 18-20 year for the first year, but it's just not motivated, it's not going to be...
Right, you need to review to the test.
I'm not going to, if they're going to come in here, they're going to come in here prepared, I don't feel that they should come in here with the mindset that, you know, I didn't do what it required prior to coming in, and then they end up failing, and then it's, okay.
Well, I want to be careful that we didn't exclude, let's say, other groups for diverse, like women who want to be police officers, so if we're going, right, we're going to prep and sort of mentor, for lack of a better word, people to kind of, you know, help be successful here, I think we need to look at all the different groupings that we can maybe, right, support, so that it's not...
Yeah.
Because we don't, again, when we speak diversity, I think our mind goes right to color and ethnicity, but I think the, you know, diversity could be also females. I mean, growing up, we had a female, of course, when I was a kid, and that's in the one I remember, you know, so I think that would be nice too for our community members to see different gender too, on the force.
I don't want to really interrupt too much, but Carol's here strictly for the civil service side of things.
Yes.
And we are starting to branch off into the things that we can make changes on our own independently, you know, in the panel. I just don't want to keep her here longer for that. If anybody else had anything specific civil service related to, again, like she explained, the administering the test, the standards, and the notifications that go out, I think, Brenda, I covered about, like, you know, most of your questions for that if you have another one. But a lot of yours went into secondary testing. We explained the policy. Is a work in progress. It needs to be amended to fit with what the Civil Service Commission does, and then we know the ways that we can petition or however the phrasing is to make changes to the Civil Service Commission and then the standards for retesting a second time over. I don't see anything else within your questions that you had to be specific for civil service and what that is. Okay.
I hear you say we have to recruit for the test, and recruiting for the test has led us to have leaders. So, I wonder if we were to put forth an idea to have like a recruitment liaison, would they be working with the commission as well? Would that be something that the commission would be open to?
So, I don't know that it would be necessarily the commission's responsibility to recruit for the police officers test. I would actually see that it would be the leadership of the department that would play that role. And I've actually talked with Todd a bit about some different ideas where I think that, you know, he could possibly look to add some diversity and the recruiting, build up the recruiting for the examination. Because the bottom line is, if you don't sit for the test and you're not on the list, you're not in the game. You don't even get to the next step. Mm-hmm. So that's what you really need to be focusing on, is recruiting to get into those communities and start recruiting to get people engaged and wanting to take the civil service exam.
Right. So Brenda, we've never recruited the right or wrong people in the past, we've just never recruited. So these are conversations I've had with the chiefs, you know, for months now. One of the things going forward, you know, in addition to accreditation, we're gonna start recruiting. We need all your help as part of that.
And I also think there's some things you can do, you know, easily, they could do. The civil service operations kind of has to keep an arm's length distance away from any kind of test prep because we have to be independent of that. And we also have access to the exam materials. And so, you know, in order for it to have integrity, we can't be involved in that. But I could work with Todd or Assistant Chief Keith
feedback of the people on this panel in terms of recruiting, and specifically minority recruiting,
yes,
like Robbie was speaking on, Brenda was, that's where I do need those ideas and assistance and a way of moving
okay.
forward and doing that, because that is something that we are lacking in currently. I don't even pretend to say otherwise. And I think the point of having California was just to straighten out again the fact that civil service works independently of the police department. So test prep, recruiting, getting out there and preparing people, making them feel comfortable to take the test is something that we would do. Separately from that, they administer a test, it's objective. No subjectivity involved, there's standards, it's video recorded at the time they take the physical agility test, so there can be no dispute as to what takes place. It's moderated by currently the Albany County Sheriff's Department, a member of their department who's certified to administer the test. So those things are done independent. We don't have influence over any of that. And the same way, like she's saying, for integrity purposes, they keep an arm's length when it comes to prepping people and everything. We would have to do that on our end. And that's something that we would accept.
Yeah, they have the permission and their help with the test portion, specifically in doing that class that really have to support.
I'm sorry, I couldn't hear
you. Yeah, because there's only three commissions. You've got three people on the commission. That's the whole board, right?
There's three, yeah.
They can mention anything they can read. If they do a test, prep, then anybody is welcome to do it.
Right.
They can't target it.
The commission itself will not be able to do it, is what I'm saying.
No, we understand.
Yeah.
If there was an ability to help the police department put together a test prep program,
yeah.
That
I'm building that right now. For Albany County Civil Service, I'm working with them. I'm building out exactly this, what we're talking about here, so that I can start recruiting a more diverse workforce into the entry-level type positions, the clerical, the custodial, those types of positions. You know, I have 1,800 employees, so I need to figure out how I'm going to diversify my workforce, and that's by getting the NAACP nominee, and the voices for the LGBT population. There's a whole list of community groups, actually part of them tonight, that we're engaging with so that we can start doing that and getting in front of people and having conversations and engaging people on what it means to take a civil service test. Have you ever thought about taking a civil service?
You see what she just said, the people who live in housing, if they would hear you say something,
they're on my list, so
yeah.
Folks are going to hear me.
Just what you said, just those little words changed people's lives.
It would change their lives.
Well, yeah, of course, we're not here tonight, we got two representatives of Cohoes Housing.
Right. But I'm just saying, what she said.
And that's a perfect thing.
Just those
that would be
words.
A perfect thing.
Yeah, that's perfect.
Okay.
I'm on the board, the housing board with Mark. So
wonderful. I served in the housing board years ago.
Yeah.
And you know, that would be perfect for your community.
Yeah.
At yeah. And we can do something like that.
Is everybody good with Carol? Just so we can.
We love Carol.
Thank you,
Carol. If anybody has, I'm not trying to rush anybody through, but I do want to get, like I said, a lot of these things so we can move on. Thank you very much.
Well, this is unexpected for me, so nice meeting you all.
Thank you.
Thanks, Carol.
And we want to call you because we would love to do more at your site with your knowledge.
Okay, well, the mayor knows how to get me, so.
Do we know how to get me?
Yes.
All right. Nice to have you all meet.
I work full time jobs.
I know.
Brenda, I know that didn't cover everything, but I think it took a good portion of what you had in between that and the policy that's going to be revamped. We'll cover a lot of those particular things. Any of the other more specific ones, I don't want to take everybody's time up on those. I can break down and meet, you know, with your group and kind of go over the other ones. But the other thing I'd like to go over, because I think it does, again, put a lot of information out there and clarify a lot of things, was the assistant chief, who will give you a little bit of his background. He's the accreditation manager for our department. Now, everybody who read the reform panel book from Cuomo said one of the big things he recommended was become an accredited agency, because that covers a wide range of things in terms of how you operate. I went over that briefly before. It's everything from how you maintain your vehicles and equipment to how you store your evidence to how you deal with disciplinary problems, how you deal with use of force, diversity in recruiting and selection and testing, and all those things. There's over
100 policies and
88
policies and a number of other standards that, that come into play. And a few people had questions last time, how does that work? This again is state mandated, you know, the qualifications you have to prove to become an accredited agency. They do audits on this. They come in and inspect and check things and make sure that you're doing everything the right way, or you lose that accreditation. So really quickly, again, to, if you don't mind, I'd like to have you speak on that and just kind of give you an overview of how accreditation works, the differences with the standards and everything, and how that actually works towards accomplishing a lot of what the reform panel is also set up to take care of.
Okay.
I'm going to
go over here. All right, just the first, like the chief said, my name is Ben Keefe. I'm the assistant chief here in Cohoes. I've been a police officer for 26 years. I was hired in 1994, became a sergeant in 2001, lieutenant in 2004. Since our, my latest promotion, I have taken over the accreditation department, as well as the detective bureau. I could go into a long dissertation about how accreditation works. It could it's extensive. So what I did.
Oh, I'm sorry, just one interruption. Lifelong Cohoes resident.
I've lived in Cohoes all my life. Born and raised, I'm going to pass these around. Yeah, I'm going to pass them down. What this basically is a flow chart telling how accreditation works. Okay, so, well, I think the best way is to do is to open it up to everyone and just see if anyone, what questions you have about accreditation. And because it's a very long and boring topic that I could go on and.
What are you missing right now in order to get accredited?
Like
how can we help in that process?
Well, as of right now, what we have done, and we're almost done with it, is we've taken, we basically went to ground zero, and we've taken all our policies, and we've gone through every single policy in our department, and we've updated each policy that we have. We're still working on it. There's a couple policies we still have to tweak. Then the process is, I have to go into the accreditation, and in, with accreditation, there's 110 standards that we have to follow. The state sets forth 110 standards. So what a standard does, it breaks it down, tells you what's supposed to be in that policy, and then they also tell you things that you have to show that you're following that policy. So there's not just, you don't just write a policy and then it fits the standard. There's also things that show that you have to document that you are showing that you are following that policy. So with accreditation, it can take up to 5 years to be accredited. Your agreement with the state is a 5-year contract. So you have 5 years. If you don't get accredited within 5 years, you have to reapply to get accredited again. So at that point, as you see in the chart, we have to just go through each policy and make sure that our policies fit our department right now. And then we move on to the accreditation. And we try to fit them into the standards. And again, the standards are broken down, like I said, is how they want it and how you're going to document how you're doing it. The process goes, once we get through and get everything in fit into the standards, then we have to have we apply to them for them to come in and give an assessment. And they do an on-site assessment, and that's a 3-day assessment where they come in, the state sends 3 representatives in, and they go through your policies, and then they determine if you fit accreditation. And once if you get accredited, you're accredited for 5 years. And then you have to be reaccredited every 5 years. But every year, you have to send in an evaluation showing that every year you're keeping up with the standards that they set forth. So accreditation is an extensive project, but it's great in the fact that you are standardized. Your policies show that you are doing what needs to be done. And to answer your question, we can look at the policies, and like I said, there's in our department, I believe there's 88 policies right now. We have 110 standards we have to fulfill. It's just we have to make sure that whatever suggestions that are put forth to us still keep us accredited. So I know people want to make change, you know, everybody wants to make change, hey, can we get that in there? And accreditation may say, we can't have that in a policy. one mistake or one thing that doesn't fit accreditation, they will not accredit it. You will not get accreditation. So.
Is there, to your knowledge, is there anything about a liaison or an officer who hired a resource officer that would stop you from getting accredited?
Like a new position?
If not in a position that adding on responsibility to one of your officers already.
No, but when you do things like that, no, I don't believe there's any situation in the policy that would accreditation look at. If accreditation, they just want to make sure you're doing what you're supposed to be doing in a certain standard. But if you're adding on to, for somebody to come in and help or do something else, they don't have policies toward anything like that.
So what would be a policy that you would say would discredit the department? And then,
I wouldn't say discredit.
We're not giving you accreditation based on their finding. Like you said.
Well, you could say, like, just say, for instance, one of the big ones, and actually, these are what you call critical standards. These are standards that these ones are, there's no getting around them. You have to be specific with these standards. But you could say, like, you're going to work.
Did you not get those?
Like, you could say your evidence room. If your evidence isn't in a certain, kept in a certain way,
okay.
Or it's not documented a certain way,
you
can lose accreditation. Or they can convince say, listen, you have to fix that.
So these are things that are already implemented.
In our department?
We have
all these, but these ones here that I hand up, these are the ones that they look at and they say, you have to have these. There is no, these are the ones when we come in and do your assessment, we are going to look at these ones, and they need to be, as I put, spot on. They have to be what we're saying, and it has to be perfect.
I think you can vary some things, obviously, you know, in a positive way, but there are certain things that you really have to be worded a certain way, or has to be done a certain way. You can't, there are other ones that you really can't deviate from.
Right. These are what you can't deviate from, and they say, and I use, for example, is the use of force policy. As of September of this year, the state put out a brand new use of force policy that incorporates the governor's executive order. So what we did is we looked at it, we said, it fits what we need to do. The state's saying, listen, you have to have this. This is what needs to be done. So we implemented that policy. We just said, this is what the state wants. This is what they're saying. We're not going to argue, and we implement it. But what that does is also, it affects a lot of our other policies. So you have to go back and, so what it did is actually bolstered our other policies, like our taser policy, our mace policy, all those other policies, because we had to put what the state was saying was required into our other policies. So it actually, like I said, bolstered those policies. So.
And that, when it comes around to some of your questions that you had about the use of force and specific things, it was one of the ones that was just 2 months ago updated.
Right.
Had to be passed, he implemented it, it's already incorporated. We have the newest version possible, you know, state approved or however you want to put it, Governor Cuomo approved for use of force that I believe addresses some of the issues that have been going on around the country and one of the reasons why the reform
was
established.
A lot of the wording that they wanted in there, that's what he put out. So we not only took that and implemented our use of force policy, but we put it in all our other policies too that were affected or come off our use of force policy. So
when he says there's 110 standards, that doesn't mean you need to have 110
right.
Separate policies. 80-something policies can cover 110 because some will take care of more than one. Just the way I explained use of force and internal affairs, and a lot of those intertwine with each other, the community relations type ones, they work together, you know. The patrol responsibilities touches on what you do, community aspect, but then there's a whole separate community interaction policy, and you know, a lot of them do overlap or intertwine to where just because we have maybe something policy doesn't mean we're not going to fit all 110 standards. We will. Some just take care of more than one.
But we have 80 policies, but once we're done with accreditation, we're going to have more policies because there's policy, there's standards that are out there that we don't have policies for yet.
Yeah.
You know, that we just, it was never required. Now we have to develop a policy.
So you haven't put them in.
Right, we have, because once I get to the, once I get to the standard and I read the standard, if we have, I can, I have to mold a policy that fits that standard. Because some of them might have, and a lot of it is like records auditing, and you know, they want us to mark down how many computers we have in the department, and everything has to be categorized. So if we don't have a policy on that, I have to develop a policy on it. So those kind of things.
Can I ask you a question? So in this instance, like you said, go state, and then you guys basically implement it here. In a situation, we'll go back to George Floyd. How do you address it with the department prior to this, prior to the implementation from the state of standard of changing how?
Well, how does, like when we do a policy, and how does it get implemented in the department?
Right, I understand that. What I'm saying is that. So this is something that we never seen, you know, with George Floyd. So, is that
what did we have in place before the accreditation aspect came out? Is that what you're
saying? Yeah, well,
we had a use of force policy.
Okay, right. Yeah, oh yeah, no,
we did have a use of force policy that I believe already met the standards at the time. We had nothing about chokeholds in there. We had nothing.
Yeah.
Those things were never implemented in the Cohoes Police Department for the whole time I've been there. There was never anything that was ever put in there that was acceptable about using chokeholds or anything. We did what I would call fine-tune it to meet these standards now, but even before that, we never had anything that said that anything like that was acceptable.
Yeah, we had a very strong use of force policy where it was when we kept our records of our use of force forms.
Correct.
Had been used by other attorneys and when they came.
I'm not saying that you guys formed it for that.
There was something. Okay. There was definitely something. It was very, like I said, very strong policy where we had instances where attorneys have come in and said, you guys, your policy is excellent, you know, because we documented even our use of force forms that we fill out.
Right.
You know, we implemented them years and years
ago. And that's going back 10 years plus
so
the time.
We didn't have that, so when that situation happened, technically, the sheriff at the time said, holy crap, you know, so obviously how they went about it was wrong, to put a picture up as a way of training, saying don't do that. We felt that it shouldn't have been a picture, you know what I mean? And his logic was that, well, if they can't understand this, then they you know who we're dealing with. Well, no, if they can't understand this and what they signed off on,
right,
then they shouldn't be working. That's how we never had anything in regards to.
We did, and ours has been, okay, like he states, have been reviewed many times.
I've been here for 26 years, and we've had a very strong use of force policy ever since I've been here. And our in-service training, that's been pretty much that. Mm-hmm. Domestic violence is the number one policy in in-service training that we've went over constantly. And like I said, we've developed the use of force forms that we have that are kept in-house, but now there's a whole different thing with the policy you read where we have to send stuff out to the state, all our use of force, any kind of use of force, we send it out to the state. So
anytime you take out your taser, whether you use it or not, anytime you take out your baton, anytime you take out your firearm, whether you use it or not, that's all reported now through the state. So there's documentation for all of that.
And that is not being reflected in the policies that you have.
Yes. Yep. And like I said, it's in the use of force, so we ended up putting that in all our other policies. So that wording is in our taser policy, our mace policy, and all those. So anytime an officer even takes his taser out of his holster, he's doing use of force form, and it's getting it's getting documented, and we're sending it out. So
in addition to making sure our policies fit the accreditation standards, also myself and the assistant chief go back and forth constantly reviewing the policies, and he can get into the details of that, but there's all these different cover sheets and forms. He gives it to me, I review it, say, let's talk about this, let's make these changes. Goes back to him, changes are made, comes back to me, and we go back and forth. Once it's decided that it meets the accreditation standards and we're happy with the fact that it meets what we want to do in Cohoes, then the officers get it. And every single officer has to sign off on it, acknowledge that they've read every single one of these, so that there's accountability and there's, a way of tracking, make sure you know how you're supposed to do these things. Because let's be honest, you can put anything on a piece of paper black and white and say you have a policy for it. But like the assistant chief is saying, and we all know, it's what you do with it. I'm sure a lot of these places and these other departments have policies against doing the things that those officers did that led to the deaths that they led to. So part of what the accreditation does, it says, you're not just going to say you're going to work on recruitment or whatever. We want to see annually or however often, proof that you are doing these things that you say you're doing. It's not just do what I say, it's show that you are doing it. You have to prove that you are actually doing these things. It's not just words on a piece of paper, it's the actions that go along with that. And I think somebody brought it up here before, I think in the first meeting was maybe Robin, said something about accountability. And that's when I mentioned, well, the accountability for the police department rests with me, and it rests with the assistant chief. We have to make sure not just that we're putting things on paper and saying, hey, read this and do it, but are they doing it? You know, and making sure that they're doing what is on paper and the policies that are put in place. That's the only way it works. And you do that a couple of different ways. You do it by example and how you did things as you were coming up through the department. And you do it through training, making sure everybody has as much training as you can get them, because like we spoke about before, the more education and the more training officers have, studies from universities prove they are not involved in excessive use of force situations or bad shooting situations or, you know, any of those or officer complaints in general. So I know I went off a little bit on a tangent there, but that is, you know, goes hand in hand with the actual policies aspect of it.
And just so you know, accreditation too is like when we put out a policy, like the chief said, it goes to him, he signs off, he marks and says he's ready, he accepts it, it goes to the members. They all have to read it, they sign off, then that sheet comes back to me, the policy comes back. I send him another form that says the department is, everybody in the department's read it, they've signed off on it, then it gets implemented. But when accreditation comes around, we have to do that every single year. So every single year, I think, we take every policy and it goes back to the guys again. So it's not like a guy gets a policy and when he first starts, and he never reads that policy again. But accreditation, every single year, he has to sign off that he read every single policy. So it's not a one-time thing. It's always, every year, it's being brought back up. And it's also being brought up in in-service training, when we're doing our in-service training and policy are brought up, and, you know, those are instructed. But it's just not a one-time thing where, you know, sometimes, because I know when I first started, it really wasn't that way. You read your policies when you started, and maybe you didn't read your policy again until something maybe came up and you had to go read your policy. With accreditation, you have to do it every single year. So it's always being refreshed.
Is that part of the officer's filing that is that public to the publisher?
I keep a file of it. I keep the file of the sheet that, you know, that they signed off on. And that's the thing with accreditation. I have to keep that so when they come in and I do a reassessment, I can show them, hey, for the last 5 years, every year, I've sent it out and everybody's.
They gave me the outline for everything. It kind of tells how
how many hours are required for each portion of the training. The one thing I'll say about that is the academy director stated that in addition to the hours that you're going to see on this form, which total, I think, around 600 and something hours, 699 plus hours in training in these different categories, he says we go above and beyond that by 100 hours. So they're closer to about 800 hours on these. If anyone needed an exact breakdown for the curriculum for each of those classes, and I mean it covers everything from constitutional law to use of force, decision-making skills, elder abuse, he says I can give you an outline for each of those classes. So here's at least an initial breakdown, but understand there's 100 plus more hours. This is the state-required standards. So this is the minimum required by the state. They go above and beyond that. And lastly, statistics-wise, there is no practical way to get crime statistics per each ward. I know that was a question that came up before. A person would literally have to input the house number for every single street to get what happened at that house and then figure it out, because wards cut across streets and just divide up the city in such a way that we have no record-keeping system for that. What I do have here is what is called our annual report, which goes over our major crimes or any of our statistics for the last 5 years. It's a good starting point, at least. And you can see on a year-on-year basis when they arrest for juveniles, when they arrest for adults, when the felonies, the misdemeanors, everything into stolen, recovered bicycles and cars. And they'll just try to give you an idea of the overall picture. I can still go through, and I will go through with the training records for each officer to find out. We do a lot of additional training in addition to what happens at the basic course. We send guys to mental health training, and we send guys to use of force training. We just actually sent four officers this last week to use of force updates. Bring this back, teach the rest of the department, and show them, you know, what are the changes that are made? What are the things that we all clearly know are unacceptable, but it's a refresher, you know, as it relates. Yes, we have another mental health training class coming up in December. We sent some officers to the new field training program once to learn how to train new officers that are coming in. So we are, as much as we can, constantly keeping up with the training. Now we know COVID is throwing a curveball. They've already started to cancel some in December. But we will do virtual training as best we can. And for October and November, we've really saturated our department and our officers with additional training because we knew the window might be small with the COVID situation. So there's a few more things to look at. We're obviously all on the same email. And if anybody needs additional information before the next meeting, again, so you can really dive in to the changes and the things that we want to modify, feel free. I just know there's a couple people who work placed on certain subcommittees. And Brenda, I'm going to step out of your talk. I think you're kind of running that show. So if you want to get with Joe Sorrell, and I know, Royal wasn't able to be here, and you can sort out who wants to be on what other subcommittees that you have for us, okay?
Thank you very much.